Thank you very much, Ivan, for all these details. So, good morning to everyone. I'm Alessandro Stroppa, and I will be the moderator for this session. So it's a great pleasure today to have Stefano Baroni that will give a talk about density functional perturbation theory, phonons. So I'll leave the word to Stefano. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Do you hear me fine?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for being with us once again. Let me start by trying to share my screen. Just a few seconds, hopefully.
It's fine.
I guess you see the first slide of my presentation, right?
Yes, it's okay.
Good. So today I will try to guide you through the combination of density functional perturbation of density functional theory and quantum mechanical perturbation theory that allows us to compute self-consistently response functions, phonons, and related quantities. What response functions have to do with phonons, hopefully I will be able to show you shortly. So let me start with a disclaimer. The material in this lecture is advanced in some sense, and its proper understanding requires a background in quantum mechanics that not all of you are supposed to have. So at the very least, I would urge everyone to concentrate on the general concepts and terminology, and to delay a detailed understanding of the theory behind to a later stage if you are not able to follow all the details. And you can ask questions to me or to other lecturers during the school, or better, study or at least have a read to the founding paper of this branch of density functional theory, that is the Reviews of Modern Physics paper by Stefano De Gironcoli, Andrea Dal Corso, Paolo Giannozzi, and myself that appeared 20 years back. So what response functions are all about? So computer simulation is about the computation of some physical properties of definite systems, such as, I don't know, the equilibrium volume of a system or the force acting on atoms. And variables depend, of course, on the positions of the atoms that constitute the material or the molecule, and also depend on the strength of an external field that you may let act on your system. For instance, the polarizability of a system or the dielectric constant is the derivative of the total dipole of the system with respect to the strength of an applied electric field. So in this case, the variable is the dipole, and the external perturbation is the electric field. The derivative of the variable with respect to the strength of the external field gives you a response function. Elastic constants are another example of a response function. Here, what you measure is the dependence of the stress or the pressure exerted by the system against the application of an external strain. Piezoelectric constants are derivatives of the system's dipole with respect to an applied strain or deformation of the sample. And all of these properties are macroscopic in the sense that the perturbation acting on your system acts on the whole of the system. It's something that you apply at a macroscopic scale. You can also think of microscopic response functions where the perturbation is something defined at the atomic or molecular scale. For instance, you can ask yourself how the force acting on an individual atom depends on the displacement of any other atom. So the derivative of the force acting on one atom with respect to the position of other atoms is a response function, a microscopic response function, because the external perturbation, that is the displacement of the atom, can only be defined at the molecular scale. And this response function is known with the name of interatomic force constant. So an interatomic force constant is the derivative of the force acting on one atom with respect to the position of any other atom. You can also define Born effective charges. Born effective charges, I don't know here, I must have made some unnoticed error, are the derivative of the total dipole of the system with respect to the position of every atom in the system. And you can continue according to the physical problem you want to address. You can define many different response functions. The main theoretical ingredient of response theory is the Hellman-Feynman theorem that many of you may have heard of, but according to my previous experience in this series of school, I remember that many of the attendees had never heard in the past about this very important fundamental theorem, and I would like to briefly summarize its statement and a very brief and elementary proof of it. So suppose you have a time-dependent Schrödinger equation, that is an eigenvalue equation for the energy of our system, that says that the Hamiltonian acting on a wave function returns the wave function itself, the very same wave function, multiplied by a constant, that is the energy of that particular energy level. The Hellman-Feynman theory addresses the following problem. Suppose that the Hamiltonian depends on some external parameter. For example, the Hamiltonian may depend on some external field, and the parameter lambda may be the strength of that field, or maybe in the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, the Hamiltonian depends on the position of all the atoms in your system. And in this case, lambda would be the collection of atomic coordinates. Whatever it is, you can always think in abstract terms of an operator, a quantum mechanical operator H, depending on a collection of parameters. These lambdas are not dynamical variables. They are parameters that you, as a theorist, should feel the freedom to set at your will, and that conceptually an experimentalist should be able to tune in the laboratory. Then the Erman-Feynman theorem addresses the following question. Suppose you can solve the Schrödinger equation. Suppose you can you have a means of solving this eigenvalue equation. How does the eigenvalue depends on the external parameter on which the Hamiltonian depends? Of course, the Hamiltonian depends on a parameter, and hence you have a different Hamiltonian for different values of the parameter. Hence, the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the Hamiltonian also depend on the parameter. Now, the question is, what is the derivative of the eigenvalue with respect to lambda? Because the eigenvalue can always be thought of as the expectation value of the Hamiltonian over the eigenvector, then the derivative of the eigenvalue is also equal to the derivative of the expectation value of the Hamiltonian over the eigenvector. Now, in order to compute this derivative, you just have to apply the chain rule. Here, this expectation value depends on lambda three times. You have a dependence of the bra, the dependence of the operator, the dependence of the ket. So you differentiate, you have first to differentiate the bra, then you differentiate the operator, and then you differentiate the ket. But now you exploit the fact that psi is an eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian. So H psi is equal to E psi. Therefore, you can bring E out of this bracket here and this bracket there, and you end up with this with the expression that the derivative of the energy of the eigenvalue is equal to the expectation value of the derivative of the operator plus the eigenvalue, the expectation value of this scalar product. But that scalar product, what is it? It is the norm of the eigenvalue. The norm of the eigenvalue is always one. Hence, here you have the derivative of a constant, and the derivative of a constant is zero. We conclude that the derivative of the eigenvalue is equal to the expectation value of the derivative of the operator. This is by no means a trivial thing, because not only the operator in this expectation value depends on lambda, but also the bra and the ket, also the wave function over which we compute the expectation value. So that the fact that the derivative of the eigenvalue does not depend on the derivative of the eigenvectors is by no means trivial. This is a property that tells you that in order to compute the derivative of the energy, you don't have to compute the derivative of the eigenvector. So this is a very powerful principle, which finds very important applications, for instance, in the computation of atomic forces. In order to compute forces acting on an atom in a system, you don't have to compute the derivative of the Kohn-Sham orbitals. You only have to compute the expectation value of the derivative of the Hamiltonian. This is the normal, the usual demonstration of the Hellman-Feynman theorem that you find in elementary quantum mechanics and quantum chemistry books. But in a way, it overlooks its generality, and it overlooks the possibility of employing this theorem, for instance, in density functional theory, where energies, in density functional theories, energies are not expectation values of Hamiltonians, are something more complicated that depend on the density and not directly, not quadratically on wave functions as in ordinary quantum mechanics. Actually, the key to the theorem is the fact that quantum mechanics is based on a variational principle. And I'm going to show you in a while that the Hellman-Feynman theorem holds every time you can formulate a problem in terms of a variational principle, be it a quantum mechanical problem or a structural problem in engineering or a problem in electrostatics or in electromagnetism. Whenever you can formulate a problem in terms of a variational principle, you always have the possibility of stating in a form or the other the Hellman-Feynman theorem. Let me go faster over a demonstration. Suppose that you can define a function of an external parameter lambda as the minimum of a functional that depends on an internal variable x and lambda itself. For instance, the energy here is the minimum over psi of the Hamiltonian, of this expectation value of the Hamiltonian that depends on lambda. So in this language, x plays the role of psi and lambda plays the role of the parameter upon which the Hamiltonians depend. So you have a function of two variables and you define a derived function as the value of the minimum of that function of two variables with respect to one of the two parameters, x in this case. The question is, can you compute g prime? How can you compute g prime of lambda that is equal to dg over d lambda? Now, by definition, the position of the minimum is, and hence the value of x at which the function is minimum, is found by solving the equation dg over dx equal to zero. Because g depends on lambda, of course, the position of the minimum also depends on lambda. So you have that the g of lambda is equal to the value of the function to be minimized, computed at lambda, and computed at that particular value of x that minimizes the g function. Now, let us compute the derivative of this. And by using the chain rule, you have that the g prime is equal to dg over dx times the derivative of x plus the partial derivative of g with respect to lambda computed at x equal x of lambda. But dg over dx at x of lambda is equal to zero. Hence, the derivative of the function of lambda is equal to the partial derivative only of g with respect to lambda. You have no contribution from the implicit dependence of the function to be minimized with respect to the x variable. Let us conclude and summarize. If you have an eigenvalue equation, the derivative of the eigenvalue is equal to the expectation value of the derivative of the operator. This is the usual, the normal statement of Hellman-Feynman. But a generalization to any variational principle states that the derivative of the minimum of a function with respect to a variable x as a function of a parameter lambda is equal to the partial derivative of g with respect to lambda computed at the minimum with no contributions from dg over dx that would multiply dx over the lambda. Dx over the lambda is something that in general must be computed. And the fact that you have not to compute it when you have when you are based on a variational principle is a very powerful concept. Now, remember, we want to compute the susceptibilities. Remember the definition of susceptibilities. The definition of susceptibility is the value of an operator. The derivative of the value of an operator B with respect to the strength of a perturbation acting on the Hamiltonian. Let us formalize this. You have a Hamiltonian that depends parametrically on a parameter lambda, alpha. Alpha is what before I had called lambda, and A is the external perturbation, be it an electric field, a strain, whatever, an external perturbation that you let act on the system, and alpha is the strength of the perturbation. Then you ask yourself, what is the derivative of the expectation value of any operator, let me call it B, with respect to the strength of the perturbation A? And we call this susceptibility chi, and we use the suffixes B and A, which remind us that chi BA is the derivative of the expectation value of B with respect to the strength of the perturbation A. Now, I play a dirty trick based on Hellman-Feynman. Suppose that I figure out a different perturbation, not the physical perturbation. A is a physical perturbation. And B is an observable that I want to measure. Now I figure out a different Hamiltonian. Where the role of the perturbation is played not by the physical perturbation, but by the operator that I want to measure. And I call this H beta, that is equal to the same perturbed Hamiltonian plus beta, the operator I want to measure. Because of Hellman-Feynman, I know that the expectation value of B is equal to the derivative of E with respect to beta, the derivative of the eigenvalue of this Hamiltonian with respect to beta. But now, if I have a Hamiltonian that depends both on the physical perturbation A and on the fictitious perturbation B, that is the quantity I want to measure, then I have very trivially that chi AB is equal to D over D alpha. B alpha, but B is equal to dH dE over d beta. Hence, this susceptibility is the second derivative of the eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian when we let the Hamiltonian depend on two perturbations at a time, the physical one A and the fictitious one B, where B is the quantity we want to measure. So let me generalize this a little bit and consider a Hamiltonian that depends on an arbitrary number of perturbations, on a linear combination of different perturbations whose strengths I call lambda I, where I goes from 1 to n, the number of external perturbations. Now I can think of considering the energy of the system as a function of the lambdas. For sure it is, because H depend on lambda, and its eigenvalues certainly depend on lambda. So I can write the a series expansion, a Taylor expansion of the energy in powers of lambda. The first derivative, the linear terms, are minus some generalized forces. I define F of I as minus dE over d lambda I. I define them with a minus. I could have defined them with a plus sign, but in order to call them forces, when the lambdas are atomic positions, so it is handy to think of the Fs as forces, and forces by definition have a minus sign. So you have a linear term whose coefficients are forces or generalized forces, and you have quadratic terms plus higher order terms. So the forces are used in molecular simulations for doing structural optimization and molecular dynamics. These second derivatives we just saw are response functions, are static response functions, including elastic constants, dielectric tensors, piezoelectric tensors, and so forth and so on, and the microscopic response functions, such as interatomic force constants, Born effective charges, etc. So let us try to give a name to these first and second derivatives using perturbation theory. How should we proceed? It is simple. You go to page 33 of your favorite textbook in quantum mechanics and compute first order, second order, higher order terms in perturbation theory. If you do so, of course, the linear terms will be linear combinations of the lambdas. And if you do so, you will realize that the forces, the FIs, are nothing but the expectation values of each individual perturbation over the ground state. Because if VI is a local potential, then a local potential only couples to the charge density distribution, and the force is nothing but the integral of, probably there is a minus sign here. Is the integral of each minus the integral of each perturbing potential times the charge density distribution. You see here the power of Hellman and Feynman. You don't have to know the derivative of the wave function or the derivative of the density in order to compute forces. You continue your exercise and you do second order perturbation theory. You may remember that second order perturbation theory implies this sum over excited states. You do the exercise. I don't have the time to do it, but it's pretty simple. It's pretty simple. You do the exercise, you expand the second order correction to the energy in a quadratic form in the lambdas, and the matrix of coefficients of the quadratic form is this sum over excited states of of matrix elements of the perturbations, the i-th and j-th perturbation computed between the ground state and the excited state. Now, this is second order perturbation theory on the energy at page 33 of your favorite quantum mechanics textbook. But if you go to page 32, just one page before, you would find first order perturbation theory in the wave function. And you will realize that this object here, this sum over excited states of this linear combination of excited states is nothing but the first order correction to the wave function. And a little exercise shows you that this is nothing but the integral of this potential here times the derivative of the density with respect to the strength of the j-th perturbation. So hij, this response function, is the integral of the i-th perturbation times the response to the j-th. You have played this game with by identifying the response to the j-th perturbation, but you could as well have played the same game with the i-th perturbation, and you would end up with an alternate expression for the second order derivative as the integral of the j-th perturbation times the derivative of the density, times the response of the density to the i-th. This I will skip. So let us frame these same results in terms of density function theory. So you have your potential, your external potential acting on the system that is equal to an unperturbed potential V naught plus a linear combination of perturbations whose strength individually I call lambda I. Now, in density functional theory, the energy of the system is equal to the minimum over all the possible densities of a universal functional f of n that does not depend on the external perturbation, plus the coupling of the external potential with the ground state electronic density under the constraint that the electronic density is normalized to the number of electrons n. Now, what does Hellman and Feynman say? This is exactly the form of the Hellman-Feynman theorem that I stated before for a general functional. So you have a functional, you have a function of lambda that is expressed as the minimum over all the possible n's. This n here is what in the previous slide I called x. X is the internal variable with respect to which the functional has to be minimum. X may be just a single variable, and in this case, this would be the minimization of an ordinary function. If n is a function, as it is in this case, because the density is a function of position, then the quantity to be minimized is a functional and not an ordinary function, but the concept is essentially the same. Hellman and Feynman says that the derivative of E with respect to lambda is equal to the derivative of the functional to be minimized computed at minimum, at the extremum. But the functional to be minimized does not depend, this universal functional F does not depend on lambda. the dependence on lambda of the functional to be minimized is only in the coupling to the external potential. So the derivative of the functional with respect to lambda computed at minimum is equal to the derivative of V with respect to lambda, but the derivative of V with respect to lambda I is VI. So the derivative of the functional with respect to lambda is the integral of VI times the ground state, the ground state electron density distribution computed at the specific value of lambda that appears as the argument of the energy. For instance, if I want to compute the derivative of the energy with respect to atomic positions, which are atomic forces, I will have to compute the integral of the ground state density n of lambda at the given atomic positions times the derivative of the external potential with respect to atomic positions, which is this VI. By pushing the differentiation one order higher, if I differentiate this with respect to lambda j, I arrive at the expression that the second derivative of the density with respect to lambda I and lambda j is equal to the derivative of this right-hand side, but the VI does not depend on lambda. So the only thing that I can differentiate in this integral is the ground state charge density distribution. So the second order derivative is the integral of the external of the ith perturbation with respect to the density response to the J, which is what we got one slide or two slides back from elementary quantum mechanics. No surprise, of course, if density function theory gave a different result with respect to ordinary quantum mechanics, something would have been wrong. We are pleased that there is no evident error, and you can move on with the take-home message that the second derivatives of the energy with respect to the strength of some external perturbation are given by the integral of the jth perturbation times the density response to the ith, or because the second derivative is symmetric in I and j, I could as well have said that the second derivative is the integral of the jth perturbation with respect to the density response to the ith. So in order to compute these second derivatives, we have to compute the response of the ground state charge density distribution. In density functional theory, the charge density distribution, as you all know very well, is the sum over all the occupied states, all the Kohn-Sham states of the square moduli of the occupied orbitals, of the molecular orbitals or Bloch states. So if you differentiate this expression with respect to whatever parameter you have that phi v squared is phi v star. And if you differentiate this product, you end up with the expression that the derivative of the ground state density is twice the real part of the product over occupied state of psi star, phi star, phi prime. In ordinary molecular computations, the the molecular orbitals are usually real, so you can forget about this complex conjugation. In an extended system, you can always choose them to be real because of time reversal invariants, but as a matter of fact, it is convenient to choose them of the block form. Block states are not real, and you have to care about this complex conjugation in your algebra. Now you use perturbation theory, and you express this derivative of Kohn-Sham orbitals. So you go to the same page 32 of your favorite quantum mechanics textbooks that you had browsed before, and you find an expression for for the correction to the Vth occupied orbital. And here the algebra is a little bit tricky, because in your quantum mechanics textbook you would find this sum extended to all the states n different from V, different from the state being perturbed. But then you break this sum as a sum over occupied states, V prime different from V, plus the sum over empty states. In what follows, I will very often call occupied states with the index V, like valence state, and the empty states with the index C, like conduction states. And if you do this this distinction between sum over occupied and unoccupied states, I won't do that now, but it's a simple exercise to show that the contribution to the charge density response of this sum cancels. It cancels essentially because here this denominator is odd in the exchange of V and V prime, whereas the numerator is even in the exchange of V and V prime. So the pair V V prime, the contribution from the pair V V prime cancels the contribution from the pair V prime V, and you remain with a sum over empty states only. This is important for practical applications. And this expression for the response of Kohn-Sham orbitals is what you find in quantum mechanics textbooks. But it has the drawback, the disadvantage of requiring the sum over all the empty states. In the plane waves applications, you have thousands or hundreds of thousands or even millions of unoccupied states. And it would be totally impractical to sum over all of them. And a key ingredient of density functional perturbation theory is to express this Kohn-Sham orbital response, these corrections of Kohn-Sham orbitals to first order perturbation theory, not in terms of a sum over empty states, but by solving a linear system. A linear system that is like an inhomogeneous Schrödinger equation. Look at this. If you did not have a right-hand side here, this would be the Schrödinger equation, right? This would be the Kohn-Sham equation. It's not minus an energy phi equal to zero. This is a Kohn-Sham equation. This is like a Kohn-Sham equation, but with a right-hand side that is different from zero. This PC here is a crucial ingredient of density functional perturbation theory. This is a projector over empty states. This is the sum over all the empty states of phi c, phi c, phi c. The crucial point here, this requires some algebra to demonstrate. I won't do this. It is a simple exercise to show that this object here is solution of this equation here. You have just to take this, multiply by H naught minus epsilon naught, and you will see that the application of this operator to this function gives this right-hand side. The crucial thing to notice here is that in order to compute the projector over empty state, you do not need to calculate any empty states, because the completeness of the plane wave base set says that the PC plus PV, PC plus PV equal to one, where PV is the projector over occupied states, and these occupied states you always have to compute anyhow. When you do a ground state computation, when you do a PW.x calculation, PW.x always returns the Kohn-Sham orbitals, always returns phi naught. So once you have a phi naught, you have a PV, and once you have PV, PC is simply one minus PV. So in order to compute this projector here, you don't have to compute any empty state. You only need the ingredients that are provided by PW.x. And here, all the ingredients are given by PW. This is the self-consistent Hamiltonian that depends on the ground state self-consistent potential given by PW. This is the Kohn-Sham orbital given by PW. PC is one minus PV, and PV we saw is given by PW. Phi naught is given by PW again, and V prime is the external perturbation. So it's something that that you know beforehand. So in order to compute the response of the Kohn-Sham orbitals to an external perturbation, you don't necessarily have to apply the formula that you find at page 32 of your quantum mechanics textbooks, so that implies a sum over unoccupied states. You can map this onto the solution of an inhomogeneous Schrödinger equation or Kohn-Sham equation that can be accomplished basically with the same algorithms that are used, iterative algorithms that are used to diagonalize the Kohn-Sham Hamiltonian to find the unperturbed Kohn-Sham orbitals in the first place. So the take-home message is response functions require the computation of the response function requires the computation of the density response to an external perturbation. In density functional theory, the density response is expressed in terms of the response of individual Kohn-Sham orbitals, and the response of individual Kohn-Sham orbitals can be computed by solving an inhomogeneous Schrödinger equation. So let us summarize and let us establish a parallel between density functional theory and density functional perturbation theory. So density functional theory is a method that allows you to establish a biunivocal correspondence between an external potential acting on the electrons of your system and the ground state charge density distribution of the system itself. How you do that? You basically express the density. Let me renumber these three steps. So you express the density as the sum of the square moduli of the Kohn-Sham orbitals, the Kohn-Sham orbitals are solutions of a self-consistent Schrödinger equation. They satisfy a one-body Schrödinger equation in the field, in an external field that is given, this external field is given by the external field that is something determined physically by the physical conditions of your system, plus an internal self-consistent field that is Hartree plus exchange and correlation. By iterating these three steps, you establish a self-consistent relation between external potential and density. This is well known by now, well established by now. In density functional perturbation theory, what you do is simply linearize each of these three steps. Basically, you replace the external potential by the variation of the external potential and the ground state density with the response of the ground state density to the variation of the external potential. And then you have to linearize these three equations. The first one is trivially linearized. The second one, dependence of the self-consistent potential on the density, and it's trivially linearized. The second is the dependence the density response on the orbital response, and this is also trivially linearized. The third, slightly less trivial ingredient is the linearization of the Kohn-Sham Hamiltonian. It is possible that I missed a minus sign here. I don't remember exactly. Maybe there is a minus sign here. Don't remember quite well. And basically, once you have linearized these three equations of density functional theory, basically, you have to solve self-consistently the set of three linearized equations, and this is what the linear response components of quantum espresso do. Done. So, what has this to do with atomic vibrations and phonons? So, basically, you can think of a perfect crystal depicted here with blue dots, described by an external potential that describes a perfectly periodic system, a system at equilibrium. And then you ask yourself what is the response of the system to the displacement of individual atoms. So you have many atoms, and you can consider a generic linear combination of displacements of each one of them. And to linear order, so to lowest order in perturbation theory, of course, the perturbing potential is linear in the amplitude of the atomic distortions. And you ask yourself, what is the energy, what is the dependence of the energy on the amplitude of these distortions? Of course, you can do a Taylor expansion of this, and the Taylor expansion in principle would start with first order derivatives. So here you should have a linear term that would go like sum over R dE over d u of R times u of R. This would be the linear term in this Taylor expansion. But the derivative of the energy with respect to atomic positions is the force acting on the atom being displaced, or minus the force, if you wish. If you suppose to start your computation from equilibrium means vanishing forces. So if you do the calculation from equilibrium, if you have pre-optimized your structure such that the forces acting on individual atoms vanish, then by definition, by construction, the linear term in this Taylor expansion would vanish as well, and the Taylor expansion would start with second order terms. The second order terms are second derivatives of the energy with respect to atomic displacements, and the second derivatives are the first derivatives of first derivatives. But the first derivatives are forces, so these second order derivatives of the energy are first order derivatives of the forces, which are called in the jargon of lattice dynamics, they are called interatomic force constants. The eigenvalues of this matrix, these interatomic force constants, are 3n by 3n matrices, where n is the number of electrons, and you have the extra factor of 3 because the displacements are vectors, so you can displace each vector in three Cartesian directions. So this matrix of interatomic force constants is a 3n by 3n matrix whose eigenvalues are the square of the vibrational frequencies. This eigenvalue problem is a little bit weird because you have this extra factor here, these masses here. I won't comment where the masses come from. If all the masses are equal, this is just a matter of units. If different atoms have different masses, then you have to take care of the differences between amongst the different masses, and you have to go to your favorite classical mechanics textbook, always at page 33, you will find the chapter on small vibrations, and there you will find an explanation where these masses in the eigenvalue equation come from. Thing to be noticed is that these eigenvalues here are indicated as the square of a real number, so they have to be positive. So positivity is an expression of the fact that when you minimize the system, you are at the minimum. So wherever you move off the extremum, the energy always increases. If by any chance you find that the square of vibrational frequencies or alleged vibrational frequencies is negative, this means that what you thought to be a minimum is not a minimum, is a saddle point. This means that by moving in some given direction, the energy would decrease rather than increasing, and this is a signal of a possible mechanical instability. So it may be a signal of two different things. Either you get negative square frequencies because there is something wrong in your computation and you have to fix it, or if after the best of your efforts, the square frequency remains negative, this is an indication of a mechanical instability, and maybe you have made bingo. Maybe you have found some interesting physical effect, and the stable structure of your system is not what you thought or what your supervisor thought. You may have found some interesting physical effect. So a system is a crystal is made of an infinite number of systems, and so in principle you have an infinite number of atoms, and this matrix of interatomic force constants in principle is of infinite rank, of infinite size. In practice, you can exploit symmetry, translational symmetry, to reduce. And so, in principle, if you wanted to compute the phonons or the vibrational frequencies of your system, you have to take big supercells, and the dimension of your dynamical matrix of your matrix of interatomic force constants would be three times the number of atoms in your supercell. But if you want to accommodate phonons of arbitrary wavelengths of wavelength of any magnitude, then you have to be prepared to do supercell calculations of arbitrary size, which is not exactly what you usually want to do, because you want to keep your computation as lean and as fast as possible. In this case, symmetry comes to the rescue. And if you go to page 33 of your elementary solid state textbook, where phonons and lattice vibrations are explained, you will see that the phonons can be classified in terms of their wave number. And so phonons of different wavelengths do not interact with each other, and it must be possible to compute phonons of different wavelengths without considering the interaction with the phonons of other wavelengths. Let us see how this reflects on your DFPT, on your equations from density functional perturbation theory. Suppose you have an external perturbation of wavelength lambda. Which is 2 pi over the wave number q. Q is the quasi-momentum of your phonon. Then the right-hand side of your DFPT equation, you remember, is the projection over conduction states times non-perturbed orbital times the perturbation. The unperturbed orbital, because of Mr. Bloch, has a definite wave vector k. But because the perturbation has wave vector q, the product of v prime k has wave vector k plus q. PC is the projector over empty states, and over empty states of all the possible wave numbers. So this does not change the wave number. All in all, the right-hand side of the DFPT equations have a wave vector k plus q. I insert this right-hand side of wave vector k plus q in the inhomogeneous Schrödinger equation, but because of the Hamiltonian here on the left-hand side is periodic, the solution here must have the same wave vector as the right-hand side, because the right-hand side is equal to the inverse of this operator here, acting on the right-hand side. But this operator is lattice periodic, and so is its inverse. Therefore, phi prime, the perturbed Concham orbital must have the same wave vector as the right hand side, so must be of wave vector k plus q. And so the right hand side, because it has a wave vector k plus q, this must be of the form e to the I k plus q r times something periodic. Same on the right, on the left-hand side. So what seems to be an equation for a wave function extending all over the orbital actually can be mapped onto an equation for a periodic system, for a periodic for a periodic wave function, for the periodic part of the perturbed orbital. By the same token, you can demonstrate by combining the response of orbitals of different wave vector, that the density response has the same wave vector as the perturbation, and the perturbing self-consistent potential has also the same wave vector as density response, which in turn we saw has the same wave vector as the external perturbation. So all the computation can be mapped onto a computation for the periodic part of the wave functions and the response wave functions, which means that the computational complexity of your system is associated to a number of electrons, which is not the number of electrons of your crystal, that is infinite, or of any supercell, which is larger the wavelength, but for any wavelength, the numerical complexity is the same as an unperturbed computation, for a computation for unperturbed ground state. So in polar materials, you have complications due to the fact that the displacement of atoms generates macroscopic electric fields. So in order to cope with the coupling between macroscopic electric fields and phonons, let me express the energy of the system in terms of the phonon amplitude U and the strength of the macroscopic field E. So the appropriate thermodynamic potential depending on lattice distortion and internal electric field has this form. It has a term that is quadratic in the lattice distortion, a term that is quadratic in the electric field, and a coupling term between distortion and electric field, whose strength is this Born effective charges that I mentioned before. The Z star is the derivative of the polarization of the sample with respect to the magnitude of the distortion. Now the forces acting on the atoms is given by the derivative of the energy with respect to displacement. You have a contribution from this harmonic term, but you also have a contribution from the coupling with the external field. By the same token, you can define the electric induction of the system as the derivative of the energy with respect to the strength of the field. This is equal to the classical electrostatic expression, that is the electric constant times the external field, the internal field, but you also have a coupling with the internal degrees of freedom, the internal distortion. Now, perturbations are never lattice periodic. They always have a finite wave number. And if you express the curl of the electric field in reciprocal space, then the curl of a field of wave number Q is equal in reciprocal space to the cross product between Q and D, and in the absence of external charges and currents, this is equal to zero. Therefore, when the polarization of the phonon is perpendicular to the wave vector of E then the only way this Maxwell equation can be satisfied is by letting the total electric field be equal to zero. If the other Maxwell equation and therefore the force acting on the atoms does not have these transverse phonons does not have any contribution from the electric field here. So for transverse phonons, the frequency is simply, the square frequency is simply omega squared. But if Q is parallel to D, then the Maxwell equation says that D has to be equal to zero. And if I put D equal to zero in this equation here, I find that E is different from zero, and hence you have an extra term, an extra linear dependence between force and displacement that modifies the phonon frequency. As a consequence of this, in polar materials, you usually have phonon dispersions that at zone center at Q equal to zero are split with the longitudinal phonon having a larger frequency than the transverse phonon. I think it's getting late, and I will skip how density function perturbation theory can compute the response to macroscopic electric fields. You will see from the previous considerations that in order to compute the response. The frequencies of longitudinal phonons, you need to have an estimate of the dielectric constant and of the effective charge to compute which you have to be able to compute the response of the system to a macroscopic electric field. This is something subtle that I won't comment upon because of lack of time, but let me just state that with some extra pain and some extra technical ingredients, Quantum Espresso is able to compute the response of the system to a macroscopic electric field. Let me just comment on where the difficulties come from. A macroscopic electric field is described by a potential that grows linearly with the position. So if you have that V is equal to minus E dot X, but the potential that corresponds to a homogeneous electric field makes the Hamiltonian non-periodic because X is not periodic and also not bound from below. this generates all kinds of difficulties that conceptually can be solved by seeing this macroscopic electric field as the limit when the wavelength goes to infinity of a perturbation of finite wavelength. So for any finite wavelength, you can compute the response to the external perturbation in the way I described before. The nice thing of density functional perturbation theory is that it allows to take the q going to zero limit, or equivalently the wavelength going to infinity limit analytically. So you can take the limit before doing the computation. And this is done with a number of tricks implemented in the codes, and the algebra and the idea are explained in that reviews of modern physics paper that I quoted before. Before concluding, let me mention the last technical ingredient that is used to compute smooth phonon dispersions. So we saw that at any given wavelength, at any given wave vector, a density functional perturbation theory calculation gives you the frequencies at that specific wavelength or wave vector without having interaction amongst different wave numbers. But you want to draw smooth curves for phonon dispersions, and what you do is compute the matrix of interatomic force constants in real space. What you do in practice, you compute these dynamical matrices here, and you compute them wave number by wave number. Then by doing a Fourier transform, you end up with a function of the distances of the atoms that interact with each other. And the smoother is the dependence of the dynamical matrix on the wave number, the shorter the range of these interatomic force constants. So when phonon dispersions are smooth, you need the few interatomic force constants to interpolate between them. Difficulties arise when you have a polar material, because this matrix of interatomic force constants is singular in the long wavelength limit as a consequence of the LO-TO splitting, of the splitting between longitudinal and transverse modes. What you do in practice, you subtract the non-analytical behavior of the dynamical matrix in the long wavelength limit. You remove hence the singularity, and you interpolate with Fourier analysis the dynamical matrices computed on a coarse grid, on a coarse grid of Q points in a reciprocal space. So let me summarize the main features of density functional perturbation theory. Response functions can be calculated in terms of response orbitals. This is achieved by solving a linear system that only requires a Hamiltonian build, only requires the application of the Cohn-Shaman Hamiltonian on the unperturbed Cohn-Shaman Hamiltonian over unperturbed orbitals without ever calculating any conduction states. We can compute the response to the perturbation you are interested in. You don't need the general response functions such as the electric matrices and the like. You can easily treat non-local perturbations such as nuclear displacement. When you displace ions, you displace a non-local potential, and so the non-local the perturbation is non-local. You can treat non-periodic perturbations, and you can easily treat macroscopic electric fields. This theory was developed in the late 80s and first applied to the computation of the piezoelectric properties of 3-5 semiconductors by Professor De Gironcoli in his Master of Science thesis back in 88 or 89. Then a number of applications to phonon dispersions appeared soon after. De Gironcoli again in the mid 90s developed a generalization of this theory to metals. So conceptually it is similar, but there are a number of technical difficulties related to the fact that you have to integrate only over states below the Fermi surface. And the number of applications have been done over the years on the electric properties, the piezoelectric elastic properties, phonons in crystals and alloys, and all kinds of vibrational spectroscopies, including phonon lifetimes, hot softening and structural phase transitions, electron-phonon interactions, and superconductivity, thermal expansion and thermal properties and mechanical properties at finite temperatures, such as thermoelasticity and many other applications. Just an excerpt from more recent literature. This theory can be now routinely be applied to systems of several dozen or a few hundred atoms, possibly mimicking disordered systems. It can compute vibrations at surfaces. For instance, the vibrational frequencies of small molecular adsorbates on frequencies on surfaces that can be used for characterization purposes. And again, the thermal properties of matter at extreme pressure and temperature conditions, such as those occurring in the interior of planets, superconductivity, and many other properties. And works come out at the rate of several hundred per year using this technology. So my work, as well as the work of all the Quantum Espresso team, is funded by the Quantum Espresso Foundation and the Max European Center of Excellence for Supercomputing Applications, that I wish to thank for their support. And this is all for today. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you, Stefano. Thank you very much for this very nice talk with all these details about the theory and also the applications. Are there any questions from the audience in Zoom? If you have some question, please raise your hands. I don't see any. Actually, I have one question on myself. May I ask, in for phonons, you apply these harmonic approximations. So can you extend, is it possible to extend these techniques, including non-harmonic terms in expansions? Is there any development on
this? There are several answers to this important and interesting question. The most trivial one is to push perturbation theory to higher order. And this is what is being done for computing phonon lifetimes, for instance. And the extension of perturbation theory to third order is almost trivial. it does not require any extra heavy computation. And this is what I skipped, one of the two, three slides that I skipped at the beginning of my talk was exactly on how to extend perturbation theory to third order using the so-called 2n plus 1 theorem. In a nutshell, what this theorem says is that the density or wave function response up to order n determines univocally the energy response up to order 2n plus 1. So if you do first order perturbation theory, this is n equal to 1, and 2n plus 1 would be equal to 3, which means that the first order perturbation theory gives easy and cheap access to third order corrections to the energy from which you can compute non-linear susceptibilities, quadratic susceptibilities, and in the case of phonons, phonon lifetimes to lowest order in perturbation theory. The other more general and non-perturbative answer will be given by Francesco Mauri in his invited talk next week. Basically, what Francesco has done is develop a generalization of the old concept of self-consistent phonons, where in self-consistent phonons, so basically what you do, you treat the anharmonic terms in the interaction in a kind of mean field way, in the same way as electron-electron interaction is treated in Hartree-Fock or similar thing. So treating this in a self-consistent way allows you to incorporate anharmonic effects into an effective quadratic Hamiltonian, into an effective harmonic Hamiltonian. And Francesco has devised a very smart way of doing this in a numerically effective fashion. And we will hear about this next week.
Thank you for pointing out. So there is a question from Uday Gayera. Think you can... you can
hello.
Show yeah. yourself and...
Yes, go ahead.
Can you see me? Okay.
Yes,
thank you.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for the informative talk. So I have a very small question. I mean, the thing is that when you mentioned that we don't need to derive the wave function or charge density, so we don't need derivation of the, if we want to calculate the forces, right? But
yeah,
when we choose like Hellman Feynman theorem, and aren't we using the like derivation of this lambda function? So lambda is already including the wave function and charge density, right? Or not?
What do you mean? Lambda is not a function, it's a parameter.
Yes, lambda. So when you mentioned lambda, that G of lambda, you yeah. said that like G of X and lambda is, I mean, very much similar to the psi and Hamiltonian.
So the correspondence that I wanted to highlight is, let me try to. So suppose you have a, I mean, let us fix the ideas and let us replace lambdas that may be confusing with atomic positions that are R, okay? Mm-hmm. And you have an energy that depends on atomic position, that is equal to the expectation value of the Hamiltonian that depends on these parameters, R is equal to lambda. Lambda is equal to the set of all the possible atomic positions. So E of R is equal to the expectation value of the Hamiltonian that depends on R over the wave functions that also depend on R. Right?
Yes.
And so this is, and psi is X.
Right.
And R is lambda. X or lambda means the value of X that minimizes G of X and lambda at given lambda. That is the value of X that solves the equation dG of X and lambda over dx equal to zero. This equation has a solution that depends on lambda, and that I call psi of lambda. This is analogous, this is exactly the same thing as in quantum mechanics, dg over dx equal to lambda equal to zero is the same thing as h of lambda psi of lambda equal to e of lambda psi of lambda. So psi of lambda is the value of psi or the value of x that solves the variational problem at given value of lambda. Or a given value of the atomic positions, in the case where lambda are atomic positions. Have I clarified a little bit the issue? I don't hear you, Yudai. You are muted.
Sorry, I was muted by a system, maybe. Yeah. That's why. Yeah, it was pretty clear. Because I was before that, I was confused by the psi of this different. Yeah, yeah.
Now it's Is it clear now?
Yes, clear now.
It's clear. Very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question and for the comment, Stefano. I think we need to stop because we have the group photo. Eventually, there are some questions on the streaming. Maybe you may have a look later. After this group photo.
Okay.
So, Ivan.
Yes, Massimo.
So let's take.
Maybe we have to talk streaming, right?
Yes, I'm here.
So, where do I find the questions? In the Zoom chat or in all black?
You can check the streaming on YouTube. There is a chat.
I'm sending you the link, Stefan. I'm sending you the link.
Okay,
so it's time to turn on your
We're
camera.
Sending the link how? On email? How are you
Zoom,
sending
I sent you the link on here on Zoom.
Okay.
Okay. As Ivan asked, please switch on all your cameras.
No, I am there. I am there.
Are you able to edit directly on the chat? You need to log in.
No, you are muted.
What?
No, you are muted.
Hey, Stefano, can you write on the chat directly or?
Oh, nice. Finally, we can all see each other. Nice.
Lower all hands. Okay.
Massimo, where do I find this 49:25 setting?
On the video settings.
Okay, let me look here.
Just go on the bottom of the menu. You will find.
Yes, that. The problem is how do I address?
I found it. Okay.
How do I address individual questions?
You just normally we put...
Is there a reply button?
No, Stefano. Normally we put at the name of the person and then you answer.
So. I think there are missing some persons to open the camera, but most of you is open, so we can start keeping the photo. So keep smiling and we start to take some screenshot. Okay, keep smiling.
Oh, even Stefan joined us. Hi Stefan, welcome.
Keep smiling. I will take.
Stefan, we are taking group photo.
Stefan, where are you? So keep smiling. I do another. Okay. Maybe this is the last. Keep smiling. Okay, I think we are done.
Nice.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, anyway, if it didn't work, I mean, it's not a big deal to do it again, I think.
Yeah.
We can do some next week.
Okay, so we take a break and then we start with the hands-on.
Okay, so let's thank Stefano again.
Okay, thank you, Stefano.
See you in a few minutes. See you later.
See you later.
Ivan.
Sì, Stefano, sei mic on, dimmi.
Ma capisco bene che c'è un limite di 200 caratteri nelle risposte.
Dove?
Sulla chat di YouTube.
Sì, possibile, sì, c'è.
Porca puttana.
Tocca dividerla.
E questo è circa impossibile rispondere. Circa impossibile.
Ma per il limite o perché la domanda è impossibile? Ah, ti sei messo muto.
L'ho messo io muto, scusa.
Grazie.
Capito?
Cosa?
Su YouTube per me è impossibile rispondere, cioè non ce la faccio. Mi va bene che qualcuno le legga e rispondo a voce, però rispondere lì ci vuole 20 minuti, c'è da copiare e incollare di continuo. Non
ci va bene, Anna, vai su Slack. Ma comunque anche più tardi, mica devi farlo ora, cioè... Non è necessario.
No, ma comunque
è più difficile, cioè,
più tardi, a parte che non c'ho tempo, perché
è più limitato, cioè,
stamattina sì, ma nel pomeriggio non c'ho tempo.
Sì, ma è limitato sicuramente.
So shall we start?
Yes, maybe we take 5 minutes more just because we finish later. Let's start at 35.
Okay.
Meanwhile, if you wish, we can try to do a technical check just to see if the screen sharing is working.
Yes.
First of all, do you hear me loud and clear?
Yes. Very well.
Okay. And now do you see the screen of the virtual machine with the presentation?
Yes, very well.
Okay.
Fine. Seems fine. Actually, if you leave it there, it's better for us because this is projected in the screen, the streaming. So if you leave it there, it's better. Thanks.
Sure.
Ah, Andrea, actually, I have to make an announcement before we start.
Yeah,
I can already make the announcement since there are already 100 people connected. So, so as we have been repeatedly mentioning during this first week, there are HPC resources available for the school that you are able to access with this a remote command that we have been showing during a number of this hands-on session during this week. So in particular, during this week, most of the lab session could have done without accessing to HPC because the system that were simulated were relatively small. And in fact, even if you were using HPC, in the range of few minutes, you could have received the output of the lab session. But from now on, the hands-on will become more demanding. So the exercises will require more computational resources to be executed, and there will be no way you can afford to perform the hands-on if you don't use the HPC resources. So for this reason, we invite you to always use or try to use the HPC remote commands so that you can warm up and learn how to use it, because when the exercises will become more demanding, that will be the only way to make the hands-on and to follow the class. So anyway, even this communication will be sent by email within today. But in general, we strongly invite you to use the remote commands to HPC resources. And if you have trouble, We have the Slack channels and we can assist you also in person. Thanks. I think we can start.
Okay, yes. So welcome back. And so we started the hands-on session on DFT-APT. And the speaker of today is Andrea Urru from ITH Switzerland and Yuri Timrov. And the tutors are Davide Tisi from CISA, Mandana Safari from CISA, and Zranic Stavitric from University of Trieste, and Matej Jus from National Institute of Chemistry of Ljubljana. Please, Andrea.
All right. So thanks for the introduction. I am Andrea Urru, the speaker of today's hands-on session. And today, together with Yuri, Davide, Mandana, Serdian, and Matej, whom I thank in advance for coming at the rescue in case you you experience any issue. As I was saying, today we are going to see an hands-on session on the first part of density functional perturbation theory that has been introduced in the previous session by Professor Stefano Baroni. And in particular, we will see the application to the calculation of phonon frequencies and phonon dispersions. So the hands-on session, during this hands-on session, I will give you from time to time some introductory basic concepts which have already been covered in the previous session, but I believe it's important to repeat them and to see them again because we need them to in order to better understand how we perform the calculation and which kind of information we find in the output files. After the quick introduction, we will have five exercises to try to perform. The first two of them are devoted to compute the phonon frequencies at gamma and the complete phonon dispersion for a non-polar material. In our case, it will be silicon. The second couple of exercises will be, again, about computing phonons at gamma and the complete phonon dispersion, but this time with a polar material, where the long-range correction that has been discussed in the previous session becomes important. And it has to be introduced. And finally, time permitting, we will go to the final exercise, which is about the calculation of a complete phonon dispersion for a two-dimensional material. In our case, it will be boron nitride. So let me start by giving a very quick introduction on the basic concepts that we have already seen in the previous session. So we consider an infinite crystal whose unit cell is made up of a given number of atoms that we identify with n at. Now, if we label with an index S the atoms inside the unit cell, this index S will go from 1 to n at. And if we further identify the Cartesian coordinates with this Greek letter alpha, then the atomic displacements, we label them with US alpha. US alpha being the displacement of atom S inside the unit cell along the Cartesian direction alpha. The atomic displacements are the perturbation that we are interested in and that are linked to the phonon frequencies, to the phonon perturbation. So this is a particular case of a perturbation that we apply to a system perturbation theory approach. I remind you from solid state physics that the number of possible atomic displacements is three times the number of atoms, three Cartesian coordinates times the number of atoms inside the unit cell. And therefore, the number of phonon frequencies that we get at a given wave vector is exactly three times the number of atoms. For instance, if in the unit cell, you have a basis of atoms made up of two atoms, then you expect to have six phonon frequencies, three times two. One of the central quantities that the code computes actually is, are these interatomic force constants, which as you have seen in the previous set, the total energy of the system with respect to the external perturbations that in our case are the atomic displacements, U S alpha and U S prime beta. If for the phonon, for the atomic displacement U S alpha, we make an assumption, an ansatz, and we write it as a standing wave, so an exponential factor in real space e to the I q dot r and an exponential factor in the time domain, so e to the I omega t, and we insert this assumption inside the classical equations of motion, so the Newton's equations, we end up with the following expression that you have already seen, that is, that you recognize as an eigenvalue problem, a secular problem, where the matrix that we are going to that we need to diagonalize is this matrix D defined in the following way. So it is linked to the second order derivatives of the total energy, the interatomic matrix, and the eigenvalues of it are the phonon frequencies omega squared, whereas the eigenvectors are the atomic are linked to the atomic displacements. Actually, this U tilde, to be precise, is the atomic displacement US alpha divided by the square root of the mass of the atom. Now, our final goal would be to compute the phonon frequencies. To do that, the code will compute for us the dynamical matrix using density functional perturbation theory, then it will diagonalize it and will print out the phonon frequencies and also information about the phonon eigenvectors, as we will see. So as you can see, that this is a formulation at a given wave vector Q. So first of all, we are going to see how to perform this kind of calculation for at a given wave vector of the perturbation. I remind you that Q is the wave vector of the phonon mode, which is related to the wavelength of this perturbation, of the phonon perturbation. So we start, first of all, let me, before starting with the exercises, let me give a quick overview of which kind of systems the phonon code can address. There is a rather wide variety of type of materials and methodologies that the phonon code covers. So you can use it to simulate, to compute the phonon frequencies for insulators, also polar insulators, as we are going to see, where the LOTO splitting appears, for metals, for magnetic systems at the simple scalar relativistic collinear level, LSDA, which I guess you will see on Monday. Also with spin orbit coupling, if you wish, you can perform electric field calculations to compute Born effective charges and the dielectric tensor, I think we will see in exercises 2A and 2B. And let me just mention that recently the theory has been extended also to compute phonons for magnetic systems when spin orbit coupling becomes important, and also it has been generalized to introduce to cover the DFT plus U approach also with ultrasoft pseudo potentials. So now I think that's all for the introduction. Then I will, from time to time, give you some other piece of information when we need it. So we start from the first exercise. where we are going to compute the phonons at gamma for non-polar materials, silicon in particular. So please go to the directory devoted for example, devoted to example 1A. So you can reach it either browsing the folders in the graphical interface or inside the terminal, typing this command. And if you list the files inside the directory example 1A, you will find four files and a reference folder. As usual, the reference folder contains benchmark results, the output files that I got from a previous run, so that you can compare with those output files if you wish to check your calculation. The README file contains information about a very, let's say, condensed information, a summary of the steps that we are going to perform. You can double click on it and the README file will open in the internet browser, so you will have it readable there. And then we have three input files. So first of all, before starting, let me make a remark. In the previous session, you have seen that in order to compute the responses, in our case, the phonon frequencies we're interested in, we need to solve a linear system. This linear system computes basically allows us to compute the first order derivatives of the wave functions. But if you remember, on the right hand side of that linear system, we had the projector on the conduction states applied to the derivative of the self-consistent potential applied to the unperturbed ground state wave functions. So a key ingredient that we need to do perform the calculation is actually the ground state Consham orbitals. So first of all, we need to compute these ground state Consham orbitals, and to do that, we have to run the usual PW calculation that by now I guess you are quite confident in performing. Then we will see a new executable, a new code, which is ph.x, which will perform the density functional perturbation theory calculation. So let us first of all perform the PW calculation. We have a look at a quick look at the input file. You have seen it already many times during this call, so I will go very quickly on that. We are going to simulate silicon. Silicon has a FCC structure, FCC Brav lattice. So I Brav is equal to 2 in this case. Here you see the size of the cube. We have two silicon atoms inside the unit cell and that are located at the positions 0, 0, 0 and 1 quarter, 1 quarter, 1 quarter in crystal coordinates. We have a wave functions cutoff of 16 Rydberg and other technical, let's say, variables that you have already encountered and met before. And this is the pseudo potential that we use for silicon in this calculation. So to run the calculation, you can actually type pw.x and source the input file and redirect to the output file. So now I switch to the terminal. I reach the day 5 example 1A directory. You can either run it on the virtual machine, but also, as Ivan was suggesting, you can use the HPC resources. And to do that, you need to, the input files are already in the HPC cluster. So you can simply type remote mpi run pw.x and minus I the and you specify the input file, which is pw.silicon.in. You submit the calculation. All right. So remember, in order to check the queue, so the status of your calculation, you just type remote SQ. We see that the calculation has already finished. So in order to collect the output files, you can use the command rsync from HPC, and then between quotes, we write star.out in order to get all the output files. In our case, it will be simply the PW output files. And indeed, we received, as you can see, the PW.silicon.out file. All right, I'm not going to open it again. You have already seen several times in the previous sessions. Remember that this step is necessary for us in order to compute the ground state Consham orbitals that we need for the linear system of density functional perturbation theory. All right, so now we need to perform the actual phonon calculation. So we now meet a new input file, the input file of the executable code ph.x. So remember, if you wish to have a look at a complete list of the variables, the input variables, you can open your browser, go in the toolbar and select phonon and ph.x, so that you will access a complete list of variables, of possible input variables that you may want to specify depending on the kind of quantity of calculation that you want to perform. The structure of the input file is made up of basically one card that is named input ph, closed by the usual slash. And afterwards, below, if you are performing a calculation for a given wave vector of the perturbation, you specify the wave vector here. So here you specify the coordinates of this wave vector in terms of in units of 2 pi over a, where a is the lattice constant, basically, in our case, the size of the cube of the FCC cell. And in this case, we are going to perform a calculation at gamma. So the phonon perturbation has exactly the same periodicity as the unit cell. Inside the input pH card, you have to, this is the minimal information that we need to provide the code with in order to perform the calculation. We need to specify the prefix, which, remember, this is important, has to be the same as for the PW calculation. This prefix is important because it tells the code the prefix of the files where it can find the wave functions, the Consham orbitals that it needs to perform the density functional perturbation theory calculation. Then we specify the mass of the atom. This A mass is the mass of all the atomic species that we have in the unit cell. In this case, we have only silicon, so we specify only one. And this TR2 underscore pH is a threshold for self-consistency. I told you before that the code solves a linear system. And this linear system, as you have seen in the previous session, is needs to be solved self-consistently. So also in this case, we need to have a threshold for in order to decide when this linear system is self-consistently solved. So the default value for this threshold is 10 to the minus 12. You can lower it if you wish. I decided to put it equal to 10 to the minus 14. Finally, the outdir directory here is commented because we are using the environmental variables of Quantum Espresso, but if you wish, you can uncomment it and you will find you will use the temporary directory .tmp. And finally, we specify the name of a file where the dynamical metrics will be stored. So remember, the dynamical metrics is the final product, let's say, that the phonon code will produce, and it will store it in a file whose name you can specify. And in this case, I specified silicon.din for the dynamical metrics. So now, in order to run the calculation, the structure of the command is exactly the same as for PW. The difference is that now we need to call a different executable file that is ph.x. So we now go to the terminal, and we can use as usual remote MPI run, as we did in the previous step, remote MPI run ph.x minus input, the input file for the phonon calculation. So we submit it, we wait for it to percolate into the HPC cluster. All right, so here you see the command that is being executed in the HPC cluster. We check if the calculation is running or if it has already finished. It has already finished, so we can collect the output file by typing rsync from HPC. We type the output file ph.silicon.out. All right, so we received the output file of the phonon calculation, and so since this is the first time that we are performing this kind of calculation, I am going to show you how this what this output file looks like. So after some general information and information about the parallelization and the geometry of the system. So you see the lattice parameter, the volume of the unit cell, the parameters of the calculations. These are similar to the PW code. You see here calculation of Q equal to 000, which is the wave vector we specified in the input file, phonons at gamma. So we are computing the phonons at gamma. Here are information about the atoms inside the unit cell and their positions, symmetry operations, the list of the K points, so something that you have already seen. And then here you have the actual calculation of the FPT. So this is a part where you have information about the self-consistent calculation solution of the linear system. So, as I told you, in silicon we have two atoms inside the unit cell. Therefore, since we expect three times the number of atoms in the unit cell phonon modes, we expect six phonon modes. Now, these phonon modes are usually grouped by symmetry. So the first three modes are solved together. The linear system for the first three modes are solved all together. And here you see for each iteration, some information about the quantity that the code checks in order to check whether we are at convergence or not. When this quantity ddvscf squared is less than the threshold, is lower than the threshold we specified in the input file, the system, the linear system is solved basically. has reached self-consistency. So here we have 3 × 10⁻⁶, which is lower than the value 10⁻⁴, which we specified in the input file, and therefore the calculation stops. Then the code goes on and solves the linear system for the other three modes, number 4, 5, and 6. Again, you find information on the solution of the linear system. And finally, here you find the frequencies of the phonon modes. So as I told you, we have 6 modes, therefore 6 frequencies. 3 of them, you see here, these are slightly negative. What does it mean, negative frequency? Actually, this is a, let's say, default choice in order to indicate that the square of the frequency is negative. So you must understand that this means square frequency is negative, therefore the frequency would be imaginary. So this sounds like weird in principle, a small problem, because you wouldn't expect let's say imaginary frequency, which are a signature of an instability in principle, as Professor Baroni was saying in the previous session, but we will see actually that this is simply due to numerical noise. So let me give a comment about that now. Well, to do that, let me just go back also to the, I close the output file, I go back to the presentation, and I comment on those frequencies. So here is a representation of the Lilwen zone of the FCC lattice. We are computing the phonon sub gamma, and here is are the phonon frequencies that we got. So you see that in this case they are slightly different from the values we have found in the output file, these first three frequencies. So this first three modes that you find, acoustic modes at gamma. So remember, every time among all the possible phonon modes, you expect to have 3 acoustic modes. All the remaining modes are optical modes. So the acoustic modes at gamma are should have an exactly equal to 0 frequency. Why? Well, if you think about that, the phonon frequency, which is a frequency of a vibration, is related to the difference in energy of the system produced by the phonon distortion. A phonon mode is actually a lattice distortion. So if you imagine to distort the atoms following a phonon mode, the energy of the system in principle would change. And this change in energy depends, of course, on the amplitude of this distortion, and can be written in terms of the frequency of the phonon mode. So now, if we think about acoustic modes at gamma, you may remember from solid state physics, then these acoustic modes at gamma are simply rigid translations of the whole crystal. So it's like we take the crystal and we rigidly shift along X, Y, or Z. So the question that I would like to ask you now is, what is the energy difference in the system due to this kind of phonon, let's call it distortion in quotes, because it's not actually a distortion, since we are just rigidly translating the system. So does a rigid translation of the system produce a difference in energy, a contribution in energy to the system? The answer is, of course, no, because of continuous translational invariance. And therefore, the energy of the system is unchanged. So if the energy of the system is unchanged, we expect, therefore, the frequency of the phonon mode to be exactly 0. Now, unfortunately, due basically to numerical noise and to numerical inaccuracies, it is difficult to have exactly equal to zero frequencies in this case. Let me explain you why. So, from the mathematical point of view, the fact that these eigenvalues of the dynamical matrix are zero comes from a property of the interatomic force constants that is called acoustic sum rule. The acoustic sum rule can be derived, you find it, for instance, well, in every solid state physics book, for instance, Ashcroft and Mermin, for instance, and from translation, from continuous translational invariance, you can obtain this condition on the interatomic force constants. Now, unfortunately, this condition is not imposed by default on the interatomic force constants when we compute them. And therefore, due to numerical inaccuracies, to numerical noise when performing the calculation, this quantity might be slightly different from zero. The sum might be slightly different from zero. So when we have this sum slightly different from zero, we get those eigenvalues, those frequencies of the acoustic modes slightly different from zero. And it may happen that that their square can be either positive or negative. So as soon as we get acoustic modes at gamma that was frequencies are slightly different from zero, either positive as in this slide or negative as we have seen here, and this value is not particularly high, so it is more or less zero, we shouldn't really be afraid of it. But nevertheless, there is a way in the code to impose this acoustic sum rule. So you can actually correct the phonon modes in order to get acoustic frequencies that are exactly zero. So, to do that, we use another executable file. As you will see in this hands-on session, the phonon code has several executable files, depending on which task, a particular task we are going to address. The main one is the PH, code that we have already started to see. But other minor, although important tasks are addressed and performed by small other executable files. So whenever you need, in this case, to address, to insert a correction on the dynamical matrix, we use this code that is called dinmat.x. So remember, every time we need to add a correction to the dynamical matrix, we use this code. For instance, in this case, we can actually impose the acoustic sum rule, which is a correction on the dynamical matrix, and therefore we use this executable dinmat.x. Information about the input file, the variables, the input variables can always be found. If you go, as always, on the toolbar, you click on phonon and you click on dinmat.x. Here you find the list of possible input variables. You see that the list is rather short because this executable file, this code, is rather small. It performs a restricted amount of tasks. For our purpose, the input file is very minimal. So the name of the card is simply input, and the two input variables that we need to specify are filled in and the acoustic sum rule flag, the acoustic sum rule variable. So filled in needs to be the same as in the phonon code input, because the DynMAT code will go to read the dynamical metrics from the file produced by the phonon code. So remember this field in must be the same as we specified in the input file of pH. Then the other input variable is ASR, which stands for acoustic sound rule, which can have several, we have several possibilities depending also on the dimensionality of the system, but for the vast majority of the systems to specify it as simple is enough. So in order to perform the calculation, the structure of the command is always the same. So you indicate the executable file minus I, the input file, and then the output file. So if we go now back, we use the remote MPI run. We submit the dinmat.x executable file. We use the dinmat.x executable file and we run using the input file. So we submit it. Sorry, I had to use minus I. Remember that we always need to specify minus I and not the less symbol when we are submitting to the HPC cluster. All right. So this should be rather quick because it's just a calcode actually imposes the acoustic sum rule and then diagonalizes again the dynamical metrics. So we collect the output files. So we do rsync from HPC and then we collect all the output files. I typed star.out because the dinmat.x code produces also a default output file by its own that is called dinmat.out. This dinmat.out contains the frequencies of the corrected dynamical metrics and that the acoustic modes now are exactly equal to zero. So the frequencies of the acoustic modes are exactly equal to zero. So those frequencies that before were negative, meaning their square was negative, so they were imaginary, were nothing to really worry about. And they were actually waiting for us to impose the correction about the acoustic sum rule. Okay, so now we just close the file. I go back to the presentation. This is again the output file we have just seen where the acoustic frequencies are zero. The other three frequencies are the frequencies of the optical modes. You see that they are degenerate, they are all the same, and this is because of cubic symmetry. So cubic symmetry imposes that at gamma, the frequencies of the acoustic and also the optical modes are all the same. And all right, so now we can move to the second exercise. I see that someone has questions, maybe. I see a few raised hands, so we can take a very quick break if there are major issues.
Yeah, Giovanni, you can ask.
Oh, okay. Can you hear me?
Yes.
No, maybe it's a trivial question, but
you can switch on your camera.
Okay. So my question is, why do we need a different program executable that imposes the acoustic sum rule? Can't ph.x impose it by default? So is there a reason why we need sometimes not acoustic sum rule imposed. I don't know if the answer is clear. If the question is clear?
Yeah. It's clear. I guess that perhaps it's due somehow to historical reason. Actually, when you do the calculation, you lose the, say, continuous translational invariance, because the real space actually in the code is sampled with a discrete grid. Therefore, you don't have by default the correct, let's say, acoustic sum rule. Then dinmat.x is an utility that is usually called also, I guess, inside the PH code when we need to do the actual diagonalization of the dynamical matrix. But as we will see later on, it has been brought outside PH in order to include other types of corrections, like, for instance, the long-range correction for polar materials. And acoustic sum rule has been inserted there also. I don't think there is a particular reason, although I should have a look at the code to understand whether there is a major issue for the acoustic sum rule to be imposed outside the PH code. So not a particular reason that I may remember. I don't know if Yuri is online, maybe knows also. No,
doesn't look.
Okay, we can move on.
Yeah, okay. So we go to the second exercise. So exercise 1B. Before we go on, before actually performing the exercise, let me provide you with some information about the very important concept of Fourier interpolation, which has already been introduced also by Professor Stefano Baroni in the previous session. I will repeat it because I believe it is really important to understand how smooth phonon dispersions are computed in Quantum Espresso. So this is an example of a phonon dispersion. This is the phonon dispersion of gallium arsenide. And using our knowledge that we got from the previous exercise, which was a calculation of phonon frequencies at a given wave vector, you may think that one can compute this kind of phi of curves and to obtain this kind of picture by running a lot of phonon codes at each of these Q vectors along the path in the Brillouin zone. So to construct this figure, this picture by points, let's say, so computing the phonon frequencies here, etc. This is a way to proceed, but it is not the smartest way. Actually, it is very computationally demanding, because as soon as you go away from gamma, you lose symmetries, and the phonon code becomes slower and slower in computing the frequencies. So it is not the fastest way to compute the frequencies at each of these Q vectors along the path in the Brillouin zone. There is a different way to proceed, which is a kind of interpolation technique, which allow us to save a lot of time and to actually compute the phonon frequencies in a very coarse mesh of Q points, instead of computing in a thick list of points in the path of in the Brillouin zone. This interpolation is rather different from the usual interpolation techniques that you are maybe used to, so linear, quadratic, or in general polynomial interpolation, And it is called Fourier interpolation because we need to go back and forth from the real space. Let me give you an overview about that. Now, suppose that we want to compute the phonon frequencies on the very long list of wave vectors that are found in the high symmetry path in the Brillouin zone. Now, we do the following. We compute the phonon frequencies, or let's say the dynamical matrices, that here identify with this general function F, in a grid, in a coarse grid of Q points. So a very few Q points. Now, if we want to then interpolate these dynamical matrices in order to get the phonon frequencies in different Q points, so those that are in the high symmetry path, we perform the following procedure. We can use the knowledge of the dynamical matrices in the coarse grid of Q points to produce an approximated function, let's say an approximated representation of the interatomic force constants, which are the Fourier transform to real space of the dynamical matrices. So basically we take the Fourier transform of the dynamical matrices using the coarse grid of Q points, and we go to real space. So now we have a knowledge about the interatomic force constants all over the real space. And then we can do another Fourier transform, so to go back to the reciprocal space, but this time when we perform the Fourier transform, we are free to choose whatever Q vector we like. And therefore, we choose the Q vectors to be those along the high symmetry path that here are represented with orange dots and are called Q prime one, Q prime two, and so on and so forth. So the blue dots can be as a low number as 8, 10, for instance, so a very low number of Q points, whereas the orange dots can be as much as hundreds of them in order to have a very fine sampling of a dense sampling of the high symmetry path in the Brillouin zone. So each of these of the parts of this procedure is performed by a different executable file in the code. So the calculation of the dynamical matrices in the coarse thin grid of Q points is performed by ph.x, so the executable we have just seen. Then the Fourier transform to real space is performed by q2r, whose name is rather self-explanatory because it goes from Q space to R space. And finally, the Fourier transform from real space back to reciprocal space in order for us to get the phonon frequencies to in whatever the list of Q points we like is performed by matdin.x. Don't get confused. This is matdin and not the din mat that we have seen before. This is a different executable. So to summarize, if we want to compute a complete phonon, smooth phonon dispersion, we need, first of all, to compute the unperturbed Cohen-Chem orbital, so pw.x. Then to compute the phonon, dynamical matrices in the coarse grid of Q points, so ph.x. Then to perform two Fourier transforms, one to the real space, so q2r.x, and finally back to the reciprocal space, so matdin.x. Very good. So, now that I have introduced, let's say that I have just recapped the Fourier interpolation technique that you have already met before, we go to the directory of example 1B. So in example 1B, you reach the directory with this command directory, the readme file. You can double click on it and you will find the instructions to follow and the input files of all the executables that I have just mentioned. So PW, PH, Q2R, MatDin, and finally also PlotBand, because we need it in order to get the post-process the data and to get the list of the frequencies in order for us to be able to produce the plot, which we will do with the GNU plot afterwards. So, all right. So, first step, I recommend you to use the HPC facilities as we have done already for the previous exercise. We perform step number one. I go and perform it very quickly. So, let me clean the terminal. Okay. I go to example 1B. Okay. I submit the calculation with .x minus I, the input of PW. We wait a bit. All right. So I check the queue. All right, this is running, so we wait a bit. I check it again. Okay, it's finished. So I collect, well, we can collect even afterwards the output file. We just then use rsync from HPC star.out to get all the output files from the that we got from the calculation. Now, second step is to perform the foreign calculation. Now, the input file for a calculation in a mesh of Q points in the reciprocal space is slightly different from what we have seen in the previous example. If you remember, in the previous example, there was a bottom line after the below the slash where we were specifying single Q point. Now instead, we don't specify a single Q point, but we specify a mesh of Q points. So as usual, we ask the code to produce automatically by itself this kind of mesh. So we need, in order to do that, to specify this logical variable, LDISP, and to set it to true. This tells the code, look, we would like to compute a phonon dispersion. And then we specify the size of the mesh of Q points along the reciprocal lattice basis vectors. So in this case, we are going to produce a mesh of two points that is 4 × 4 × 4. Here you find the way the code produces these vectors, these wave vectors Q in that will identify the mesh of two points. So I, J, and K run from 1, 2, and Q1, and Q2 and Q3 respectively. We run the calculation. So we go to our directory. We type, as usual, remote MPI run. This time, ph.x minus I, ph, the input file. Wait for it. All right. This time, the calculation should take a little bit longer because we are performing a phonon calculation at each of the Q vectors of the Q points in the mesh. So if you type remote SQ, you might find that you're still, that the calculation is still going on. Yes, it is. So we just wait for it. It should take, well, in the virtual machine, it was taking about 2 minutes. So perhaps in the cluster, it should take also less than that. Okay, still going on. Let me check it again. Okay, still going, so we wait a bit. So what the code is doing now is computing the, it is computing the dynamical matrices over the 4 × 4 × 4 Q mesh. Let me, so the Q mesh is placed inside the Brillouin zone of the XCC lattice in our case. And as we will see in a while, actually, the mesh of Q points is reduced by symmetry in a way similar to what has been done, is done also for the K points. And this has been already, you have already seen before in the previous days. So in principle, the complete mesh of Q points would contain 64 Q points, but many of them are equivalent to each other. So the code checks which Q points are equivalent to what, and the equivalent Q points are eliminated, so only the non-equivalent ones are considered. In this case, as we will see in a while, we will have 8 non-equivalent Q points. So the Phonon code is computing the dynamical matrices in these 8 Q points. Let me check once more. Still going, so let me I go to just to check the calculation, so we can do HPC if you wish, and this will let us enter inside the very same directory on the HPC cluster, and I use this command to check instantaneously what okay, the calculation is just finished. So you see job done here. So we can just exit. We are back to the virtual machine and we collect the output file so that we can have a look at it. So we do rsync from HPC and we get all the output files. Okay, so let's have a quick look at the output file of the Phonon code. So basically here you have information about the mesh of Q points. So here you see there are 8 Q points. These are the coordinates of the Q points in units of 2π/A. You go on, the information is similar to what we have found before for the single Q vector calculation. And then here you find the self-consistent solution of the linear system at gamma. This is the first Q point. Then we go on, we find the frequencies at gamma. Again, you see the slightly negative frequencies, which are due to the missing of the acoustic sum rule. Then we go on and we should find the calculation for the second Q point. So here you see computing dynamical metrics for this is the second Q point in the list that you have seen before. And then you have again the solution of the linear system for all the Phonon modes and so on and so forth. And this is done for all the Q points in the mesh, so all the 8 Q points. We have also let me take it. The DIN files, which contain the dynamical matrices at each Q point. So we can collect them. They are called silicon.DIN, DIN, and then they are followed by a number. So I type silicon.DIN star to get all of them. Okay, so you see they are nine. There are nine files, DIN 0, DIN 1, up to DIN 8. The first one contains the list of Q points that were already printed also in the output file. So you have information on the mesh for 4 and 8, the number of inequivalent Q points, and the Cartesian, let's say the coordinates of the Q points. And then in each of the remaining 8 files, you have the dynamical matrix for each of the 8 Q points. Very good. So now we are in a position in which we have the dynamical matrices in a coarse grid in the reciprocal space. So in order to perform now the double Fourier transform, first of all, we go to real space. So from the knowledge of the dynamical matrices in Q space, we perform this Fourier transform that is that you find written in the red square, in the red box here. And this is done by Q2R. So basically we run Q2R, which will apply essentially this formula where NQ is the number of Q points in the grid, which will be, for instance, in this case, in our case, 8. Let us have a look at the input file. Again, these very small executable files require a rather minimal input file. The input file for Q2R contains the name of the dynamic of the file that contains the dynamical matrices, which once more, remember, must be identical to the one we specified in ph.x. Then it contains information on the acoustic sum rule that we want to impose. And then finally, the name of the file where the force constant will be written. So the function that we get in real space, because remember, we are performing a Fourier transform from reciprocal to real space, will be written in this file that we call silicon 444, because we are using a 444 mesh.fc. So we run the executable. So remote MPI run q2r.x minus i q2r.silicon.in. And we wait for it to finish. Again, this is just a calculation of a Fourier transform. It is rather fast. So it shouldn't take more than a few seconds. So we check if it finished. It did, so very good. And finally, the last step is to compute the Fourier transform back to the reciprocal space. So from the force constant we have just computed, we go to the reciprocal space in a set of Q prime points that now are the points along the high symmetry, along the high symmetry lines. So to do so, we use the MATDIN code. So basically, here we see a screenshot of the input file. We need again to specify the acoustic sum rule that we want to impose in order for the acoustic frequencies at gamma of the atom, because that is needed, because you remember it, it is found inside the definition of the dynamical matrix, so we need the mass of the atoms. Then the file containing the force constants, which has been produced by Q2R. So important point, this must be the same as the one we specified in the input file of Q2R. And finally, a file with the frequencies. So This will be an output file produced by Matt Dean, where we will have a list of frequencies at each Q point, at each of Q of the Q prime points, so at each of the points along the path. So, and finally, after the card input, we give the code a list of Q prime points. So you see, this is the number of Q prime points where we will compute the phonon frequency, will interpolate the phonon frequencies, and that will make up our final picture, our final phonon dispersion. You see, here we specify almost 400 Q points. So going back to the very beginning of this exercise, when I was discussing the Fourier interpolation technique, if we were to compute the phonon dispersion point by point, so running a single phonon calculation for each of these 400 Q points, well, you easily understand that it would have taken forever. Instead, with the Fourier interpolation technique, we just compute the phonon frequencies on eight, in our case, eight Q points. So the 4x4x4 mesh. And then by means of this trick of this Fourier transform, interpolate the frequencies to whatever number of Q points we like. In this case, we chose something near 400. So here you find, if you open the matdin.input file, you find a complete list of the Q points. Now we run matdin. So remote MPI run matdin.x minus I the input file. Once more, this is simply a Fourier transform. So although we are computing it much, we see indeed that it already finished. And now we collect, okay, we collect with the command rsync from HPC, first of all the output files. All right. So we have also the matdin.silicon.out file in the Q2R. And then we collect also the silicon.frequency.frec file, which will be needed for to plot the phonon dispersion. So rsync from HPC silicon.frec. All right, we have a quick look at it. So here you have basically six bands, so six frequencies, because we have six modes for each of the 396 Q points. And here you find information about the Q points, the coordinate of the Q points in the first line, then the frequencies, the six frequencies, second Q point, and the frequencies of the second Q point, third Q point, and its frequencies, and so on and so forth. And this is done for all the 396 Q points along the high symmetry path. In order to produce the plot, this is the very last step, I would say, we run plotband.x. This is a minimal information on the input file, which I guess you, perhaps you have already seen in the previous days, perhaps you have already used to compute to plot bands. If I remember correctly, it is a serial program, it is a serial code, so we run it directly here in the virtual machine. We type plotband.x and with the input file, redirect to the output file. Okay. So let me see. Okay. And so the plotband.x executable produced these frequency.ps and frequency.plot output files, which already contain a version of the picture that we want to get to the Fanon dispersion, but to get it more appealing, let's say, we then use the GNUplot utility to compute to represent, to plot the Fanon frequencies. So I already prepared for you an input, source file plot dispersion.gp, a GNU plot file, which will produce the final version of the picture, and we can have a look at it using the A3 command, and then Fanon dispersion is the .eps is the file. So here you have, this is a, more complete final picture that contains also other graphs that we can, that I got from other calculations. Let me go back to the presentation in order to comment on it properly. So this is the Fanon dispersion we got, obtained with the grid 4x4x4. You see the lowest frequency are the acoustic modes, the modes with higher frequency are the optical modes. This is a representation again of the Brillouin zone. And however, one may ask whether our technique, our approach with the Fourier interpolation technique is accurate enough. Because, you know, basically we are computing the dynamical matrices in a very coarse grid of Q points. So the representation in real space of the interatomic force constants that we get from the Fourier transform is, of course, an approximation. So how good is this approximation, and how good is the interpolation that we are performing? This, of course, depends on the size of the mesh of Q points. So as usual, the thicker the mesh, the better the approximation of the interatomic force constants. The smoother, the more accurate the interpolation is. How to decide whether our mesh of Q points is thick enough to get a reasonably accurate interpolation? Well, there are two ways to perform this kind of convergence test. The first way is to compute the very same Fanon dispersion with several meshes of Q points. For instance, here I produced a plot also with a mesh with 2x2x2 points, but you can do the same for thicker mesh if you wish. You see that going from the 2x2x2 to the 4x4x4 mesh, basically the Fanon dispersions are still changing in a rather evident way, I would say. And this means that for sure the 2x2x2 grid of Q points is not thick enough to get an accurate representation of the interatomic force constants. Now, you can, if you wish, go on to the 6x6x6 or 8x8x8 meshes, but remember that as you increase the thickness of your, the size of your mesh, there are more Q points, and therefore the execution of ph.x will be slower and slower. And for doing so, I would highly recommend you to use the HPC facilities. So as a homework that I leave you now is for later on, whenever you wish to perform this kind of calculation, you can, for instance, perform calculations for other Q grids, 2x2x2, 6x6x6. You collect the silicon.frec file then that you obtain after performing the matdin calculation. You run plot band for each of these 2-point grids, and you can represent them, plot them using the GNU plot script that I have prepared for you. So you can include then in the GNU plot script the names of the files containing the frequencies for each 2-point grids and get a final nice picture. Another way is to do a direct calculation. So as I told you, since these curves that we obtained are an outcome of an interpolation, you can check the interpolation by simply computing the real, dynamical metrics and the phonon frequencies at that particular Q vectors, for instance. So basically we are doing in this case single Q vector calculation. And for each Q vector, we compute the phonon frequencies and we represent them with a blue square. So I have already performed this kind of calculation for you just for the sake of clarity, of showing the result. And you see that the single Q vector calculations fall quite well on top of the red curve that we obtained with the 4x4x4 mesh. So we can conclude that the 4x4x4 mesh of Q points is thick enough to allow us to get a reasonably accurate interpolation of the dynamical matrices and of the phonon dispersion. If you wish to reproduce this kind of plot, I leave you another homework so you can run a single Q point calculation using the templates that you find in the exercise in example 1A. So basically you need to specify the coordinates of the Q vectors, and at each time you use the coordinate of a different Q vector. So this, that, and so on and so forth. And I provided you with already a list of possible Q points that you may want to use. You find them in the reference folder in this text file, Q points direct calc. So these are two ways of checking the convergence of the Fourier interpolation. So it's rather, long, I would say, and divided into parts, this kind of Fourier interpolation technique. But I hope I have been clear enough to let you understand what are at least the important main steps that you need to perform in order to compute a complete smooth phonon dispersion. This is also a comparison with some experimental data that you can find online, and you see that the red curve reproduces very well the experimental data that are identified with these magenta dots. A word on a phonon modes visualizer before we move on. So as I told you, acoustic and optical modes are rather simple to imagine and to understand at gamma. Acoustic modes are rigid translations. Instead, optical modes are characterized by motions of the atoms in the unit cell in counterphase. So if you have more than one atom in the unit cell, for instance, for silicon, we have two, the optical modes at gamma are characterized by the two silicon atoms moving in counterphase. So when one moves up, the other moves down, and so on. But as soon as you go away from gamma, the wavelength of the phonon perturbation does not match the unit cell. So the periodicity of the phonon perturbation is different from the periodicity of the crystal, and it is way harder to understand and to imagine how these phonon modes are, let's say, represented with atomic in terms of atomic displacements. There are several tools online, but the one that I like the most is this on produced by Materials Cloud, that you can find in the Materials Cloud website. This reads directly the input file of PW and an output file produced by Matt Dean that is called mattdean.modes. So if you feed this online tool with these files, you can get the phonon dispersion, which is in the mattdean.modes. This information on the frequencies in the mattdean.modes file. And then you can click on interactively on the phonon dispersion. You can choose a Q vector and the phonon branch that you like. And you will see how, in an interactive way, how the atoms inside the unit cell move. And you always can have the chance to see the also the unit cell of your system, so as to understand how the phonon displacements are modulated because of a vector. So just a final word still on Fourier interpolation. Now, the Fourier interpolation technique, as has been already said also in the previous session, works very well when the interatomic force constants are, when the phonon dispersion is sufficiently smooth. When you have variations, let's say, of the wiggles of the phonon dispersion is in a very short range of Q points in the Brillouin zone, then you wouldn't be able to capture them with the Fourier interpolation technique. There are cases where this happens. For instance, for cone anomalies in metals, cone anomalies are basically wiggles of the phonon dispersions and these wiggles are very narrow, let's say, they appear in a very short scale in the Q space. So if you do a Fourier interpolation, you might not be able to get them. And another class of systems where the Fourier interpolation somehow fails or needs some more advanced correction is the polar insulators. In that case, as Professor Baroni already explained, the dynamical matrix has also a non-analytical part. That non-analytical part cannot be computed, addressed by the phonon code itself in the self-consistent solution of the linear system, but needs to be added separately. So we will not cover cone anomalies in this presentation, in this hands-on tutorial, but instead we will address in the next two exercises the case of polar insulators. So before going on, I saw before there was a raised hand. I don't know if the person would still like to ask the question. Or I don't know.
Andrea, you can read the two last questions in the chat on Zoom.
Okay, let me see if I can see that, because I don't know if I am. Okay. All right. So
the last two for
so Q to R is no. Okay, one is, what are the differences in structure between DIN MAT and MAT DIN dot, this one, MAT DIN dot yes. files, how to build dot frec file. All right, so the DIN MAT file performs a correction to the dynamical matrices. So there you specify input variables that are related to acoustic sum rule, to long range correction, as we will see in the following exercises. Whereas MatDin is a different code which performs the Fourier transform back to the reciprocal space. So the main difference is that in MatDin you basically provide a complete list of Q points that you want to for the Fourier interpolation. Whereas in DinMat, well, this is it's a different code. It has only corrections on the dynamical matrix of a single Q vector. And then the .frec file is produced by default from plot band. So let me go back. The plot band file.
Andrea, sorry, yeah. Just to let you know, you have half an hour left.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay. The .frec file is produced by the plot band code. So it is a default output file produced by that code. So let me see again the other question. How to know the best number of Q points for the inverse Fourier transform? Okay, so, well, you can, let's say, the Q points that you specify in matdin.x, you can, in the input file of matdin.x, you can choose whatever you like, you can try and see how, with a given number, see how the plot looks like. If you choose a too low number of Q points, the Fonon dispersion will be too much piecewise, let's say, like several segments. So I would suggest some hundreds of Q points in order to have a rather smooth Fonon dispersion. Okay, so I guess it's enough, right, Yuri? Or are there any more questions?
Sorry, I have some question, if I may.
Yeah.
So first, I missed something about the matdin.x input file.
Yes, so I go back. Let me go back to the.
Because I think that after the all the flags, there is the K-path specification. Mm-hmm.
No? Yes.
So that K-path specification is just the one, taken from, for example, X-case, then like for electronic
yes.
band structure.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay.
Yes.
But the fourth number is the weight of the Q points, I assume.
No, the fourth number is actually a variable that represents basically the length, the overall length of the Q path. So if you were to represent all the whole Q path in a line, as we are doing actually in the Fonon in the plot, the fourth number is a number that specifies the ongoing length of this line, basically.
Okay, so it's the distance.
So depending
it's the distance with the successive Q point.
Yes, yeah, basically, okay. Yes. And it is an increasing number. So as you go on along the Q path, this number increases, yes.
Okay, so, and then I have some other question general about the code. So first of all, if we can access from the diagonalization of the dynamical matrix also the Fonon eigenvectors, so the polarization vectors
yes.
of the Fonons.
Yes, that the eigenvectors, I didn't mention them. You can read them in the .din file.
Okay.
So the silicon.din, for instance, contains both the frequencies and the eigenvectors. So you can have a look at them there.
Okay. And does the imposing the acoustic sum rule also changes the eigenvectors accordingly?
Yes, because you are changing the dynamical matrix, and the dynamical matrix is then diagonalized once more. Therefore, the phonon eigenvectors are cleaned, let's say.
Okay. And so, last thing, what is the phase convention chosen to compute the dynamical matrix? Because you can use as a phase only the lattice vector or the lattice vector plus the atomic position in the cell, no? And this doesn't change doesn't change the frequencies, but changes the eigenvectors.
Ah, okay. I guess it's the lattice vector, if I am right.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Andrea, there's a question from YouTube.
Yes.
There's a question. Where do I specify the high symmetry Q points in the input for the dispersion curve?
Okay. Well, the high symmetry points are not... for the dispersion are specified here in the matdin.x file. So below the card input, you find a number where that tells you the number of Q points in the high symmetry path. And then below you find the complete list. So in the matdin.x, the input file of matdin.x.
Yes, if I can add, there is also another possibility to add two keywords. It's like Q underscore...
In band form.
Exactly, in band form, yes. Mm-hmm. And also in crystal units, I think.
Yes,
crystal. So in that case, yeah, you can explain maybe that part.
Oh, yes, there is a possibility also to specify the path by giving only the initial and the final point of each segment of the path. For that purpose, you need to specify the flag Q in band form. It is something that you find in the description of the input variables of matdin.x that you can access from the toolbar of the internet browser of the virtual machine. And in that case, you specify simply the first and the last point of each segment, so that you don't need to provide a long list of Q points. And of course, you specify the first, the last point, and then a number that says how many points you want the code to put in between the two extrema, let's say the two. The initial and final point of the segment. Okay, may I go on?
Yes, of course.
Okay, so no more questions.
Well, if you want, there is one.
For the time being.
Yes, there are some, but maybe you can answer later also by chat.
I can go on and.
Yes. I think you should go on.
All right. So for the exercise 2A, well, this is a brief recap about the theory that has been shown in the previous session. So when we are dealing with polar insulators, there is also an additional non-analytic term to the dynamical matrix. Well, non-analytic means that it depends on the direction we are choosing to approach gamma, basically. So this is the true meaning of non-analyticity. So this contribution will depend on which direction we are following to approach the gamma point. This quantity, this additional piece, depends on the Born effective charges, Z, and on the epsilon, which is the dielectric tensor. And both of them can be computed with an electric field calculation. So in order to do so, let us perform the exercise. The first step is, as usual, the pw.x calculation. So I go to example 2A, we use a, as usual, remote MPI run w.x minus I, the input file. This time we are going to address to study aluminum arsenide, which has the same structure as silicon, so FCC with two atoms per, per unit cell. One is aluminum and the other is arsenium. So we check the status of the calculation, which is finished, and then we perform the phonon calculation. So here, the only difference in the input file from previous examples is that we specify this epsilon logical variable and we set it to true. And this will allow the code to perform an electric field calculation, so the response to an external electric field, which will allow the code to compute the Born effective charges and the also the dielectric tensor. So we run now the phonon code, so ph.x minus I, the input file. This is a single Q vector calculation, similarly to exercise 1A. And indeed, the Q vector here is 0, 0, 0. So we wait for it to finish. And then we will have a look at the output file. At this stage, we are not still, we're not inserting yet this correction that is needed for polar insulators. So we are computing only the analytical part of the dynamical metrics. Therefore, the LOTO splitting that has been mentioned before, which is a, an effect purely due to the non-analytical part, is will be absent basically. So we take the output files right. We have a look at the phonon output file, so you can view directly from the slides. So if you open the output file, you will see that the frequencies, well, you have here the information about the dielectric tensor and also the effective charges. This can be found in the output file if you browse it. And then if you look at the frequencies, you see that the three frequencies of the optical modes are exactly the same. So this is still due to the symmetry of the system because the system is cubic. But then as soon as we include these non-analytical effects, a splitting will arise. So now I'm going to show you how to include this kind of non-analytical correction. As I told you at the beginning in exercise 1A, every time we need to introduce an, a correction on the dynamical metrics, we perform a calculation with DINMAT. So we run DINMAT. Here I show you the input file with respect compared to the previous exercise, to the previous time we have seen it. This time we are specifying also the Q vector that appears inside the correction, this Q here. Because as I told you, this non-analytical correction depends on the Q vector, depends on the direction we are approaching gamma. Basically, it's like we are taking the limit of the dynamical metrics for Q that goes to gamma. But since this this quantity is non-analytical, we need to specify along which direction we are actually taking the limit to gamma. So in this case, I am performing a calculation along 1, 0, 0, and we can quickly do it. I just show you how to type the command, and then I just show you the output file in the slide. So remote MPI run dinmat.x minus I din mat dot input. Once more, this is a very short, quick calculation. You can always check with remote SQ the status of your calculation, which has already finished, and then get the output files, which is dinmat.out. Okay, so if you open the output file, you will see that now the optical modes are not degenerate anymore. Two of them are still degenerate, and these are the transverse optical modes. So modes for which the motion of the displacement of the atoms is perpendicular to the Q vector, and instead the longitudinal mode has a higher frequency. All right, so this is about the LOTO splitting at gamma. The exercise to be instead is aims to compute a complete phonon dispersion in aluminum arsenide, so that you will be able to see the LOTO splitting in the neighborhood of gamma also. As usual, we switch to the example to be folder. Now, this time I made things a little bit harder for you because I erased a few input variables from the input files, but I have not been so mean, let's say, to completely erase them, but I left some information inside the input files. For instance, in the ph.input file, if you have a look at it, every time I erased an input variable, I put a comment on the right. So you see here, you need to specify a prefix, and remember it has to be the same as in the PW input file. Then you need to specify the mass of aluminum, the mass of arsenium, and then the size of the mesh. So this is a more kind of hands-on exercise. So you need to open the input files, check if there is some information missing, insert it, and try to run the calculation. So you can then follow the steps that you find in the README file, which are exactly the same as in the exercise 1B. But since I see that we have more or less 10 minutes before the end of the session, let me just ask you to perform the exercise by yourself and report problems, issues, if you find any in the Slack channel, and I will be glad to answer and to provide you with help if needed. So I just show the result. Basically, here is a recap of the steps that you need to perform. It's not a long exercise. I mean, ph.x takes as usual a few minutes. So if you want, you can try to run it also now, but remember, you need to carefully check the input files, because if you miss any input variables that I erased, the code would crash, of course. But let me show you the final picture that you should obtain. This is the phonon dispersion of aluminum arsenide. And here you see that at gamma, approaching gamma, we have a clear splitting between the transverse optical, which are the lowest frequency ones, and the longitudinal optical, which is the highest frequency one modes. And so this splitting you always have when you are approaching gamma. And the size of the splitting, as I told you, may depend on the direction you are following when approaching gamma. This is the meaning of the true meaning of non-analytical behavior, or non-analytical contribution. So just to go to the third and final exercise, I sketch what you are supposed to do. Basically, this is a calculation of a complete phonon dispersion. So again, it is very similar in terms of the steps you need to perform to exercises 1B and 2B that we have just seen. So from the practical point of view, it's rather easy. You follow the instructions in the README file and you are able to perform the calculation. But what I would like also to point out here is a physical effect that arises in this kind of two-dimensional materials. So as you have seen before in the school, when you are dealing with low dimensional materials, you need to specify also this assume isolated variable inside the input file of PW. This allows you to cut off the dipole-dipole interactions, if any, between the system and the periodic replicas that you have. So for the foreign code, there is a similar flag that is called LOTO_2D, which is a logical variable that needs to be set to true when we are dealing to low dimension, in this case, two-dimensional systems inside the input file of Q2R and also in matdin.input. This needs to be done because as has been pointed out in a recent paper, even if we are dealing with a polar material with a two-dimensional polar material, the LOTO splitting is killed in that case. So if you are working in reduced dimensionality, the LOTO splitting at gamma is vanishing. And in order to be able to reproduce it, you surely need to set this variable to true. So here is a very sharp summary of the steps you need to perform. And since we have slightly less than 10 minutes left, I don't think we are able to perform it completely because this time the phonon calculation will be slower. It takes about 5 to 10 minutes also in the cluster facilities, in the HPC facilities. But you can still try to perform it. As usual, you use the remote MPI run command to send the calculation to the cluster. So first of all, the PW calculation. Okay, and then it's running, and then the phonon calculation, the Q2R, and the matdin calculation. Then you collect the files obtained with matdin, and you run on the virtual machine plot band and GNU plot to get the phonon dispersion. So let me just see here. I would like just to send the phonon calculation, which, however, will take a while. Sorry, remember always to specify minus I. And yes.
Can I interrupt? I think this is the example that will not run with 20 processors, right? Oh.
I'm sorry, yes, you are right, Tony. I forgot. Remember to this example in the HPC cluster doesn't work with 20 processors. That is the default value that has been set for this kind of calculations. You need to specify a different number of processors for the parallelization, which we chose to be 8. So you need to correct the command by specifying nproc equal to 8 before the command. So nproc equal to 8 and then remote MPI run and the executable minus I, the input file. So you send it, since I already sent the phonon, the phonon calculation, let me check. Okay, probably it already crashed, so no problems. I don't need to cancel it. And the same for the phonon calculation. So I go back to the remote MPI run phonon here, and I specify nproc equal to 8 before the command. Okay, and in this case, the phonon calculation will be performed by the HPC cluster. As I told you, it takes about 5 to 10 minutes, so I don't think we have time now to see again the output files or complete the task, but I am confident you should be able to run also Q2R and MatDin, which are very fast, and you should obtain the following phonon dispersion, where you see a couple of key signatures of low dimensional materials. One is that the third acoustic mode, which has atomic displacement perpendicular to the plane of the material, do not increase linearly going away from gamma, but they increase quadratically. This is a key signature that is found also in graphene, for instance, and this kind of mode is usually called flexural mode. Instead, concerning the LOTO splitting, although boron nitride is a polar material, you see here that there is no LOTO splitting at gamma, which is, a physical effect due to low dimensionality, and that has been explained in a paper that I mentioned also in the very last slide of this presentation. A different way to proceed, if you want, is to not use assume isolated, but just increase the vacuum, so the empty space between the replicas. But this is a rather inefficient way to proceed, because you see, it appears an LOTO splitting, which gets lower and lower as you increase the vacuum space, but then you need a very large vacuum space in order to get a zero LOTO splitting. Eventually, you would need an infinite vacuum space, because if this is a calculation I have done by myself, so I'm just showing you this result. If you plot the frequency, LOTO splitting as a function of the thickness of the vacuum space, you see that to go to zero, you would need an infinite vacuum space, basically, because this dependence is linear in a log-log scale, which means that it decreases as a power law, basically, with increasing vacuum space. You can try to perform the calculation by yourself and report problems, of course. I will be more than glad to, on Slack, I mean, will be more than glad to address the problems. I leave you, you can find the slides on the website of the school. I leave you with a very, very minimal bibliography on the topic. You can use solid state physics books to cover phonons and LOTO splitting. Also, it can be found in this book about optical properties by Mark Fox. And then fundamental papers that drew basically the foundations of density function and perturbation theory, the one by Baroni, Giannozzi, and Test of 87, the one about phonons in 91, the Review of Modern Physics of 2001. And if you're interested in the effect of low dimensionality on the LOTO splitting, you can have a look at the paper number 4 that is reported here. But this is, as I told you, a very, very minimal bibliography, and a more extensive study is needed to really cover and address the topic. With this, I'd like to just thank you for the attention. And it's 12:30, but if you want to stay a little bit more or 5 minutes, if there are still questions, I can take them now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Andrea, for this insightful presentation with all the details and a procedure how to perform these calculations. So, I don't know if there are some questions, some people can ask, can raise the hands.
I can browse also the chat in Zoom.
Yes, you can have a look there directly.
All right, so I go backwards. Why we have made LOTO to D true when there is no LOTO splitting into D? Okay, so if you don't set LOTO to D true, you would get an LOTO splitting, because the code thinks we are working in three dimensions, and this is correct, because actually you encapsulate your 2D material in a cubic box, basically, which is three dimensional. And in that case, if you don't specify the LOTO to D true, you would find an LOTO splitting. Let me go quickly to the point. So if you don't specify LOTO to D true, you find an LOTO splitting, which is unphysical. In order to, and you need to specify that LOTO to D true, which as a result will kill the LOTO splitting. Okay, so how we can compute the zero point energy using the Phoron calculations at gamma point? Okay, so for that purpose, you use the thermal effects can be computed using the whole Phoron dispersion. And this can be done. This can be done, for instance, with the ThermoPW utility, which is another code that can be downloaded and run into Quantum Espresso that computes the thermodynamic quantities such as the zero point energy, specific heat and other related quantities. Then, let me see. Okay, I don't see anymore. Ah, okay. How about bending modes in the Z direction for the last example? So, bending modes, I mean along the Z direction, so perpendicular to the plane. These are those flexural modes, I guess, which are the Phonon branch with quadratic dispersion near gamma. That is the flexural mode. With this calculation, you basically get all the Phonon branches. So. Perhaps I'm not getting correctly the question. I don't know if perhaps Yuri wants to add something, if he understood better than me the question.
Sorry, I was answering to the other. Which one?
Oh, sorry. There is a question where, how about bending modes for the last example? Is it possible to compute? I mean, along Z direction, I guess this is the flexural mode.
I'm not sure I know what to answer.
Okay. I think we can stop here, and for any other questions you can write on Slack, and let's thank the speakers again, Andrea and all the tutors, and of course Stefano Boroni for the
thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. See you later. Later we have this guest lecture. So see you at 2:30. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.